Hello! In this episode of Bug Bounty Reports Explained, I will show you a brand new attack technique discovered by one and only James Kettle, client-side desync attacks. Specifically, I will focus on the way that thousands of servers could be hacked that used Akamai. This technique gives us a variety of ways to leak user data, and I think even James himself wrote in the article that he left a lot of bounties on the table for us, so watch closely. As always, links to the sources are in the description. Enjoy! This episode is sponsored by Intigriti. Intigriti is Europe's biggest bug bounty platform with over 400 programs to hack on. I hugely appreciate Intigriti for investing a lot in community enablement. They create an awesome Bug Bites newsletter, they create monthly XSS challenges, they even have a great YouTube channel. If you are not one of over 50,000 hunters, check out Intigriti now using the link from the description. I will start with explaining what is pipelining in HTTP 1. So normally, when the browser sends a request, or when you send a request from Burp, it looks like this, one request, one response, nothing unusual. However, you can also send two requests at the same time, and the server will give you two responses. Although this is not used by browsers anymore, it's a feature, not a bug, at least not by itself. But how does the server differentiate between this being two separate requests or one with a body? To help the server solve this problem, we use the content length header. It tells the server in bytes how long our request is. And the server knows that whenever the first request is finished, the next one begins. If you are using Burp's repeater, this header is updated automatically. If you try to send these two requests with default settings, Burp will update the content length header and you will actually send one big request. However, if you turn that option off and set the header to zero, the server will see two requests and issue two responses, of course, if HTTP pipelining is supported. But not every single request contains the content length header. In fact, most of them don't, because most of requests use the get method, which doesn't contain a body, so this header is useless because it would always be set to zero. And the server just doesn't expect a body when you're requesting, let's say, a static image. If you manually change the method from get to, for example, post, the servers still respond with this static image, which doesn't really make sense to me, but it's probably to be even more error prone. The fact that normally these requests don't have a body doesn't mean you can't send one. Let's see what happens when you do. This is a simple image request which we can send to a vulnerable server. We can do the same using post method. And also, we can use the request body, but the server doesn't use it in any way. And let's prepare the body of the request so that it looks like another HTTP request. If we send this, do you think we will get one or two responses? Based on what I said earlier, this is one big request with a body of 30 bytes, so we expect to get one response. But this is when we get to the client-side desync problem, because even though we sent the valid content length header with a value of 30, the vulnerable server did not use this header. It's because this endpoint never consumes a request body, so it assumes the content length header is zero. And it probably worked fine for years without any problem, before James Kettle came with his new research. So what a vulnerable server sees is that the first request ends here, and this is a second one, meaning it will also send two responses. The question you should be asking yourself now is, why is that actually a problem? Because this is not really different from this, and we could basically send the second version anyway. And that's a very good question, but the breakthrough with client-side desync is that with previous request smuggling techniques, you had to use burp or even tools that worked on a lower network level. But this attack can work with the browser. Because when we send this request, there is absolutely nothing out of line. It just happens to have the body that looks like an HTTP request, but it's nothing invalid. It's the server that ignores the content length header and assumes it to be zero. You can use this to confuse the browser, because the browser wants the amount of requests to be equal to the amount of responses. And in this case, the browser thinks it sent one request, but it got back two responses. So what does it do? When it sees the next request using the same connection, it will respond to it with the unexpected second response. There is a whole variety of ways you can use to exploit this bug, but in this case, let's see the technique that allowed to hack many websites built on Akamai with an XSS. The first thing you need for this technique to work is an endpoint that ignores the content length header. Your best candidates are static files, redirects, or different errors. The bug was in Akamai itself, so it affected many websites, but we'll stick to an example of the whole exploit on Capital One. If you requested a file without a trailing slash, it redirected you to the same location but with the trailing slash. You could also use a post method for this. And this is what you send to the server to confirm that it ignores the content length header. There are actually three requests. The first is the one that you want to check if it's vulnerable to client-side desync. With the second and the third one, you must be able to differentiate them by looking at the response, because you will get some response from the server and you must determine which request did the server respond to. In this case, let's say for the robots.txt request, we expect 200 OK response code, and for the assets, we expect a 403 forbidden. The value of the content length header of the first request must be between the second and the third request. If you count the characters, there are 24 in the first line, 4 in the second line, and new line is actually 2 bytes, one for the carriage return and one for the actual new line, which gives us 30. When you send this, you should get 2 responses. If everything works fine, the server will see the first request with this one as a body, which ends exactly between requests. So this would be our second request. So for the first one, you expect a redirect, and for the second one, you expect the response to the assets request, which means you expect a 403. If that's the case, it means you did not find client-side desync vulnerability. However, if the server assumes the content length of the first request to be zero, you will also get 2 responses, but the second one will be the response to the robots.txt request. The server will also see a strange looking header, but it's nothing out of line. If that's the case, you are very likely that you just found a browser-powered desync. To confirm this, you can use this perfectly valid fetch call. In fact, if you prefer, you can simply start testing without using burp, but with this fetch call. What will happen under the hood is the browser will send this, thinking it's a one big HTTP request. The server, however, will ignore the content length header and will send 2 responses over the same connection. The second one will be left hanging. So the browser will match the first response to the first request, as it should, and will want to follow the redirect, so it will send another request over the same connection. And in this connection, there are already 2 responses, so the browser will simply return the second response to the request. Let's see how we could turn this client-side desync into an XSS on Akamai website. Like every client-side bug, client-side desync is executed from the victim's browser, which means that we need to prepare our malicious website with malicious JavaScript code and trick the victim into visiting our website. This is the setup that we want to achieve in our connection. The first request is our initial vulnerable one. The second one is a head request to which the server will respond with text HTML content type, and this response must have content length header, even though it's a response to a head request, so it won't have a body. The third request will also contain an XSS payload in a header, which will be reflected in the response header. Normally, this is not a problem and it's not exploitable, so it shouldn't be that hard to find. And at this point, the browser will think that it only sent one request, while there are three responses in the same connection. So the fourth request sent by the browser will be poisoned by headers from the second response, and headers from the third one will be the body of the response. So we want to make sure that this fourth request will not be just a fetch call, but it will be a top-level navigation so that the XSS payload executes in victim's browser. But normally, the first request will return a 301, so the fourth request would be the browser following this redirect as a fetch call. To prevent this, we use mode course, which will cause the browser to throw an error and not follow this redirect. And instead, in the catch block, we'll use the top-level navigation to redirect the victim to a new website which will be poisoned with our headers and our body. And the last problem is that if these two responses are left hanging for too long, the browser will just discard them. So we add the cached buster parameter to the head request so that it's processed a little bit longer to prevent this. So this is the final exploit that, if sent from victim's browser, would result in an XSS. If my video helped you to understand client-side desync, I'm very happy and I'm proud of you, because I know this is not easy. However, this video did not cover the whole research, and I will write about some other parts of it in next week's BBRE Premium. If you are not a member of BBRE Premium, go to bbre.dev/premium and subscribe. For now, thank you for watching and goodbye.